It's like an all-out war with monsters at home. Welcome to NS Game Reviews CCG Edition. And welcome to my second attempt actually trying to film this. I actually had this filmed several months ago, and then I went on a little trip to Tampa, Florida for a gaming website I write for. I got to check out WWE 12 in the final stages of development, pretty much playing the final code. Great trip, got to meet one of my favorite superstars, Sheamus. But as for another video, I decided to do so. Bottom line is, it was either before or after the trip. I went to clean up my camera, and it was deleting anything that I thought I didn't need. It didn't hit me until a while later, I accidentally deleted my Magi-Nation video. Whoops. So, yeah, this is technically the second time I'm fully recording my review for Magi-Nation. I can't really say much about this game right off. I mean, it was out for a few years before it kind of went belly up. I mean, the manual's from 2002. Definitely looks like it. But needless to say, this is one of the only games besides the big three, again being Magic, Pokemon, and Yu-Gi-Oh, and even Yu-Gi-Oh wouldn't fall under this. This is actually the third game. Or the only other game, I guess you could say, beyond Magic and Pokemon, that I actually invested money into. As you can tell, I've got a few decks here. You can see the white one here is a lot smaller than the others. I color coded my decks with sleeves. And these are all just spare cards. I'll get to what the white cards here soon enough. Now, if you're wondering right off if Magi-Nation, the card game, is any relation to the animated series that's on TV right now, yes. The TV series, as far as I know, is based on the creatures and such from the game. I've never fully seen an episode of the animated series. I probably ought to check it out. It's on Netflix. There's also a Game Boy Color game. Again, I don't know if that was more of an adventure game or just a port of the card game. I had never played it. Maybe I'll check that out one day, too. So, let's go ahead and grab a deck here. Just grab the first deck I can grab. Again, the game was made by Interactive Imaginations a while back when some of my cards say copyright 2000, 2001. So, yeah, it's made around the time that I was in college. And, of course, it was definitely different than other card games. I mean, it's something different besides Magic. I mean, don't get me wrong. Sorry, I just kind of lost my train of thought into why I have that. Well, I have a couple of these different cards in here. Anyways, so it came out around the time I was in college. It was something different than me and a friend could play besides just Magic constantly. Don't get me wrong, Magic's a fun game. I love Magic to death. But, you know, there's something different. So, one of the good things about Magi-Nation right off, if I can find the right cards, there are only four different types of cards. Let's see if I can find a good example. Ah, there we go. Yeah, so there are four different types of cards in Magi-Nation. There are Magi cards, relics, creatures, and spells. So, let's go and get right into it. Let's go and clear my box of cards here off my desk. Out of the way. So first, let's go ahead and check out Magi. Magi it's pretty much like your main characters in the game. Each person will have 3 Magi in their decks. No more, no less. Magi are the ones who pretty much deploy their spells, their relics, and their creatures. Lost my train of thought. I was going to go through all 4 cards quickly and then go back and describe them, but I'll stick with what worked. So up here in the corner, you see like a little tent up here in the corner. Don't know how well you're going to be able to see this. That represents the Magi's starting energy. Their energy that's lost in battles, you can spend it on playing spells, creatures, relics. If Magi has a power or something that causes or makes you spend energy, it comes directly from the Magi. A Magi is typically defeated when their energy is 0 and they have no creatures in play. So if you have a bunch of creatures in play, you can freely spend all the energy on your Magi as long as you know. Busting on my desk, I knock over cards. You can spend all the energy on your Magi without risk of losing your Magi, as long as you are pretty confident that. As long as you're pretty confident that your creatures, at least one of them, will stay in play for the next turn. I guess I set out. I need to find anywhere to sleep for that one. Give me a moment. No, I knocked another card. It's only good. Improv, folks, it works. There we go. I'm just clumsy today. Okay. So, if I can do this without completely knocking things over, continue. Magi also have an energized cost. If you're playing a 2-player game, actually, one of the first steps of a turn I'll get into in a little bit is the energized step, which you put energy on your Magi equal to their energized cost. Unless it's a 2-player game, you're the first person and you're taking your first turn, but it's kind of like not drawing the magic first turn. I'll get more into energizing in a little bit. Starting cards, when you first reveal the Magi, again, might be hard to see. When you first reveal the Magi, you can take any or all of the cards listed by starting cards and add them to your hand right away. Then you have, this Magi, Nara, doesn't have any powers, but she has 2 effects. Effects are, think of static effects from the magic, they just happen when they do. Like, for instance, effect resistance. All Urgars and Giles in play that you control are unaffected by non-called spells. Which means, and called being one of the regions, which you can see here under the name says Called Magi, if you can see it. I really need a camcorder. I should have Magi here. Power, yeah. So let's go to Borga here real quick. She has the power Shatter for 2 energy. That says choose any one creature with 3 or less energy, or any one relic in play. Discard the chosen creature or relic from play. What that means, if I want to use this power, I take 2 energy off of Borga and do what it says. The catch is with powers, you can only use the power once per turn. Strike that. You can only use a given power once per turn. If you have 2 powers, you can use them both once a turn. And it's once per turn, not per step. Now, be more relevant here in a bit. So that's really it for the Magi. Next up, we're going to just go with creatures. Creatures, this cute little guy here. These are what represent the Magi in battle. I mean, that was kind of a poor way of putting it, actually. Magi send the creatures out into battle. Simply put, to play a creature, you can see it has an energy cost up here. That's a starting energy. Magi and creatures don't have any max energy. But to play a creature, actually to play anything, your Magi discards the energy, or discards the energy cost of the card. And then for creatures, they get energy equal to that starting energy. So if Vorga were to play Fire Choco, for instance, or Chogo, I'm sorry, not Choco, Chogo, says in Final Fantasy. She would take 2 energy off of her, and it actually go directly onto Fire Chogo. So for creatures, you can kind of see it as moving energy from the Magi directly to the creature. Creatures also have their different regions. This came, in this case, it says called Dream Creature. I mean, it's a color creature. I think almost all creatures will say Dream. Yeah. They also have their own powers and effects. For instance, Fire Chogo says, Power, Heat Storm. Discard Fire Chogo from play to discard 1 energy from each non-called creature. Not bad if you know you're going to lose it soon. The thing with powers on creatures is if there's a cost to play them, like an energy cost, that comes directly from the creature, not the Magi. It's just lost. It's gone. But that's pretty much it for creatures. Next up, we're going to go with... actually, there's one more thing I do want to mention with creatures. I'll probably get more into it later, but I do want to mention one thing. For the most part, Magi can play cards from any region. But they're not playing cards from... mostly from their region or from Universal. There will be a regional penalty, which I'll get into more later. So... yeah, I think that for a second. I'll get more into the regional penalties later. Next up, we're going to go with spells. Spells are like instants in magic. It also has a cost. The cost comes directly from the Magi. It doesn't go anywhere else. As you pay it, use the effect and gone. For instance, Thermal Blast is a call spell. Costs 3 energy to play, so I would take 3 from Vorga directly. It says, roll 1 die. Choose any one creature or Magi in play. Remove energy equal to the die roll from the chosen creature or Magi. You do what it says, and discard. Simple as that. I think because of the sleeve, I'm not using this deck in the demo. So that's really all there is to spells. Finally, there's relics. These are pretty much like the artifacts of the game. Of course, yeah, again, I have a casting cost, so a lot of these don't cost anything at all. And again, the cost comes directly from the Magi. Think of it as like an instance, so to speak, that stays in the play and just has ongoing effects. For instance, a Scroll of Fire here is actually a rare card. It says, Effect Pyromancy. Whenever a spell you play or a power on a creature you control discards energy from an opposing creature, discard 1 additional energy from that creature. So it's as simple as that. But basically, that's all there is to it, really. Let me just quickly... recap, you have Magi who are the ones who play as power spells and relics. You got 3 of them in the game, but in your deck. Get the creatures that go out and fight other creatures and the Magi. Spells are like your instances in the game, and relics are your artifacts, so to speak. That's really all there is to it. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and, kind of tilt the camera down. We're going to get into a little more about the game, about how it works, how to play cards and such. Except I'm not using this deck because of that. I got a couple more here, anyways. Definitely need sleeves. So I'll get a couple other decks here. I'll get to you later. And so I think I have another deck here to check out. I gotta check something real quick rule-wise. So when I come back, the camera will be tilted down, and I'll get into more of how the game works, so I will be back momentarily. Alright, this might be a little hard to see. It really all depends here. so let's kind of go ahead and try to go ahead and... say go ahead a lot and go ahead and do this and go ahead and okay. So before I really get into how the terms of a game works, I'm going to mention or talk about real quick on how to play characters. There's one thing I need to grab real quick here. Back when me and my friend were really getting into this, I actually got something specifically for this game. That was a bunch of D6s. These make great energy counters, and you can get them at local hobby shops or game shops. This is a set of, I believe, 36 dice. And again, they are really useful for this game. We need all 36. Not likely, though. Me and my friends have had games go up quite a bit. And if you can't use them over here, hey, they can always be used in Magic. Alright. So let's talk a little bit about how some cards are played. For this, we're going to, let's see, who should I throw out? Let's go ahead and throw out Walt. We're going to go ahead and say he has 10 energy on him.
We had another 5 seconds on my first turn.
So he energizes. Like I said, I'll get more to energize later. Grab starting cards here real quick. I'm pretty much trying to get a decent hand going so I don't have to fish for cards for examples. So starting cards for the record are Deep Hyren, Carrick, and Submerge. I'm going to Submerge. Pretty sure I have them in here. There's Carrick. We have Deep Hyren, though. Nope, I don't have Deep Hyren. Not a problem. So I got a couple there, anyways. I'm just going to randomly shuffle, make this realistic. Okay, so I'll get more into the face of a turn in a second. I just want to try to have a realistically good hand. Never mind, I'm just going to wing it here. Do I have a rock? Please tell me I got a rock. Yes, I do. Let me take that works. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about how playing cards works. Just a sign. So first I'm going to say it's my turn. And again, I'll get more into the phases of the turn in a second. This is just how certain cards are played and how they're going to work. So I got Wall out here, and I'm going to go and play creatures. So I'm going to go ahead and play Carrick. Carrick has a starting energy of 5, meaning it costs 5 energy to play Carrick. So I would take 5 energy off Wall, and then I would put 5 energy on Carrick. So, like I said earlier, it's kind of the analogy. You can just take the energy from the Magi and put it directly onto the creature for the most part. I'll get more into that in a moment. Now, Carrick has an ability here. That's called Steel, and has a 2 energy cost, and it's actually a pretty long power here. Choose any one player and a relic controlled by that player. Place the chosen relic under Carrick. While Carrick is in play, relics with the same name cannot be played by the chosen player. Relics under Carrick are not affected by spells and powers. When Carrick leaves play, return any relics under Carrick to their owner's hand. So pretty much, I can pay 2 energy from the creature to steal a relic so my opponent can't use it in any way. And that energy would come directly from the creature. Wall also has a power here called Dream Twist for 5 energy. This says, choose one of your creatures in play. Discard the chosen creature. Play a creature from your hand without paying its energy cost. Put energy onto the play creature equal to its starting energy. That creature may now attack this turn. Now, here's the catch. That's an expensive ability, and probably not one that might see too much use unless you have a massive creature in your hand. Just kind of show, I've only got 2 of the creatures in my hand with starting energies of 3 and 4. So trust me, with low power creatures, that's not worth it. And in fact, I might see if I have another Oroth Magi to change out, because that's probably not going to help too much in this deck. But if I were to use it, the energy would come off of Wall for the power, and it just goes away. And then the power takes place. Let's go ahead and check out relics. I have one here called Orothian Goggles, if you can see it there. Don't know how good this is here. Has no cost with the power of Foresight. Look at the top 2 cards of your deck. You may discard either or both of these cards, or put them back on top of your deck in any order. It's a free relic, and it's a free power, so I can go ahead and just look at the top two cards in my deck. Sorry for the delay, I had to read these. I have Implosion and Undertow. Both spells. Implosion is not bad. Choose any one creature or Magi in play. Discard X Roth cards from my hand. Roth again being region. Discard X energy from the chosen creature. Not bad, I'm not too fond of it, so I would discard that. And then Undertow is nice, though. Choose any one creature in play and discard it. The chosen creature's owner then shuffles that creature back into their deck. So it's... It looks like a boomerang from Magic. It just goes back to into the deck, though. So interesting, though, so I might keep that one. And that's how relics work. Finally, you have spells, which are... Again, they're like instants. The energy for spells comes directly off the Magi. So I would go take all from 10 to 8. If I were to play Submerge, choose any one Oroth creature in play and add 3 energy to the chosen creature. So I've only got one Oroth creature in play right now, so I'll just put another 3 onto it. It's simple as that. So in terms of how to play the cards, that's it. But there is a little more to it. There's a couple things I'm going to go ahead and bring up called regional restrictions and regional penalties. For the most part, any creature or any Magi, like I said, they'll belong to a specific region, like Orphea here belongs to the Oroth region. And you can play any creature and any spell from just about any region. The only catch is, if it's not universal, and it's not the region of that Magi in any way, it costs one more energy to play. Now, there is a catch here when it comes to creatures. That one extra energy is a penalty energy. And actually, I don't know if you can see me here. I'm trying to get into view without moving the camera. That one extra energy is a penalty and does not go onto the creature. It's just discarded. So, for instance, if Orthea wanted to play a called creature that had a starting energy cost of 3, it would actually cost Orthea 4 energy to play it, but only 3 would go onto the creature because of the starting energy. The additional penalty point is just gone. Simple as that. Spells are the same way. They cost 1 additional for universal spells. Relics, however, are one of the types of cards that have a region restriction. Relics cannot be played by any region other than their own. I guess it's the best way to put it. So Orphea can only play universal relics and Oroth magic, or Oroth relics. It's not like it costs an additional 1 to play other regions' relics, you just can't play them. The other type of region restriction is with Core and Shadow Magi. Core Magi can only play universal cards as well as core cards. They can't even play creatures and spells from other regions. Shadow Magi are a little different. They too can only play universal and core cards for the most part. There are some other regional cards I'll say shadow on it, like Shadow Oroth creature or Shadow Weave creature or something like that. And those can be played by Shadow Magi, but they will also incur the regional penalty of 1 additional energy. So, just a couple things to keep in mind when you're trying to play these cards. So with that, we're going to go ahead and go through the basic steps of a turn here and how things work. First things first, you have your 3 Magi. For this demonstration, I've got Wall, Orthea, and Bria. I'm using my Oroth deck. You put these in any order you want, and they're going to be face down to start with. So don't be like, okay, I want to use Bria first. Let's go Wall, then Orthea. You turn them face down, and all of a sudden Orthea is your first Magi. You didn't want that. So you want to put the first Magi you're going to use first on top. And I'm going to go with Bria for that, followed by Wall, and then Orthea. A lot of times it may not necessarily matter which order. It all depends on what your deck's like. And then turn them face down. So, at the very start of the game, I'm going to go ahead and shuffle my deck real quick here, too, just to get a little you have not even done anything yet, don't even bother shuffling your deck yet, per se. Really all depends on what you're going to do first. Because first you start out the game like this. I mean, you have your Magi stack and you have your deck. That's what you have to start with. So the first person goes, and they're going to overturn their top Magi. They're then going to look for their starting cards, which for Bria is two non-universal relics from any one region. So I already know right off what one of my relics is going to be. And I was going to go with Hubdra's Spear. And we're going to go with Arothian Goggles. Now I'll go ahead and shuffle my deck. If you're looking for specific cards, like in other games, you must show the cards to your opponent. If you look for any card at all, you don't have to show them. In this case, I am looking for any two non-universal relics. So are specific, or from any one region. So, since I am looking for specific cards in a way, I still gotta show them. So, there's your deck. You want to go ahead and draw enough cards to go up to 5. And that is your... That's the beginning. I'll go ahead and put your starting energy on your Magi. In this case, 12 for Bria. So, first phase of the turn is the energize phase, and if you're going first, you don't energize. Something I do want to mention, though, is the way the rulebook implies, let's say this is a two-player game. Let's say I'm just playing against one other person, blah, blah, blah. I go ahead and do all my starting stuff like that. Until the end of my first turn, my opponent's first Magi is still face down. And it's not affecting them in any way, so I can't do anything to them. So, and then at the start of their first turn, they'll do everything I just did. So we're going to say it's a couple turns in, just so I can show you how Energize works. You just put the mount next to Energize on the Magi at the beginning of the turn. So in this case, 5, that would put Bria up to 17. Again, if you're going first, and it's your very first turn, you don't Energize, unless it's a multiplayer game. So looking at my hand here, I've got Spore and Husp, a couple creatures, Shell, which is a spell, and then my two relics. So after your energize phase, you go to the PRS, or the first PRS phase. This is kind of like your main phase in Magic. There's just a slight catch. That is, you cannot play new creatures during this step. PRS stands for Powers, Relics, and Spells, and allows you to play just that. Powers and effects on Magi, or relics and spells from your hand. Here's one thing I do want to mention. That did kind of miss on Bria, though it doesn't really have any effect on my deck. She has an effect called Obsession. It says, when you reveal Bria, name one region. Bria may play relics from that region regardless of regional restrictions, which is why her starting cards are two non-universal relics from any one region. However, I think my Aroth deck is literally all Aroth cards, so that power really doesn't do much. Again, I suck at deck building. I can definitely edit this deck a bit. So, powers, relics, and spells. Well, let's go ahead and play my Rothian Goggles to get out of my hand. I showed how that worked earlier. Then we're going to go ahead and play Hubdra's Spear, which has the power of Stab. So for 4 energy, I can choose any one Magi with no creatures in play, discard Hubdra's Spear from play, discard all but one energy from the chosen Magi. Relatively useful, or could be, towards the beginning of the game. If you can't, don't get it at the beginning of the game, the reason why it's useful is if you can get big powerful creatures out to take down your opponents, you can quickly reduce their energy to 1 and make it so they don't really do much of anything. So, otherwise it might be best to hang on to it. Now I do have a spell in my hand called Shell. It says, until the end of your next turn, your Earth creatures in play are not affected by opposing spells and powers. If an opponent's power, spell, or effect discards one or more cards from your hand, you may discard Shell from your hand instead. If you do, discard all of that opponent's relics in play. All ongoing powers and effects of those relics are canceled. So, not too effective right now. So I'm going to end my first PRS step. Next comes the attack step, and I'll get to more on attacking here in a minute. But obviously it's the first turn of the game, if it was. I know I energized. You see where I'm going with this. If it's your first turn, obviously you're not going to attack because you don't have any creatures yet. So after your attack phase, though, and I'll get to attacking here in a minute, you actually go ahead and go to your play new creatures phase. Now you can play creatures from your hand, and I've got two I'm going to go ahead and use. First is Spore. Spore is an heroic creature. Cost two energy from Bria. Has the effect of Scavenge. It says each time a creature you control is discarded from play, add one energy to Spore. Pretty useful. Next up is Husp, which has a starting power of 4. Max Bree down to 11 total. It has the power of Ensnare, which says discard Husp from play. Search through any player's deck. You may remove up to 3 different cards from the deck and place them in their owner's hand. Or the owner's discard pile, I'm sorry, and shuffle the deck afterward. Interesting. I'll get more into that here in a minute. And that's all for my play new creature step. Step 5 is powers, relics, and spells. The second phase, so kind of like, again, main phase. I mentioned earlier that powers, you can only use a listed or a given power once. You can use multiple powers a turn, but you can only use a power once. Per turn, not per step. So it's not like you can. So it's not like I can use Foresight back during my first PRS step, and then use it again. It doesn't quite work like that. Since I didn't during the first PRS step, I'm going to now. So pretty interesting actually. And I'm actually going to keep them both. So the sixth step, once you're done playing powers, relics, and spells again, the sixth and final step is the draw step in which you draw two cards. In my case, it's the two cards I just looked at, the goggles, which happen to be Submerge and Typhoon. Submerge, I mentioned earlier, choose any one heroic creature in play, add 3 energy to it. Typhoon says roll one die, discard energy equal to the die roll from each non-heroic creature in play. One thing I did want to mention that I completely forgot about a minute ago when playing creatures. I mentioned original restrictions and penalties. Some creatures will have two different regions in its region text, and it's treated as being from both of those regions equally. So, for instance, and I gotta go back to my call deck for this one. I know I've got a creature in here that qualifies. I'm called Karkik. Karkik is a Kybar's Teeth slash Cult creature. What this means is that both Kybar's Teeth and Cult Magi could play this without a regional restriction. As such, if a card can affect either Kybar's Teeth or Cult creatures, it can affect Karkik. Likewise, if a power spell or whatever cannot affect either a Kybar's Teeth or Cold Dream creature, it cannot affect Karkik because it is, again, equally one of those, or both of those, regions. So, I did want to mention that, and I completely forgot. In a sense, though, that's pretty much how turn works. So, what I'm going to do now, I'm going to set up a little, demo game here real quick. Just to kind of show fully how this works. In fact, I'm going to save myself a little bit of time real quick here. So I'm going to shuffle that, and I'm going to pull out probably one of my favorite decks that I have, and that is my Core and Bog Wrath deck. Or so just my Core deck. Full of Core spells. So we're going to go in. Let's go. That's not going to work too well. Actually, it all depends. If I go first, this could be incredibly useful. So, go there, and we'll see what happens. So, we're going to kind of see a bit of a Magi duel here going on. See if I can get all these in play. I'm going to check to see how well this shows up on camera here, because I want to try to get as much of this on camera as I can. Okay, actually gets on the camera pretty good. Okay, so we're going to say that we're not going first yet. So, I'm going to say, hey, Margaret, or core player here is going to roll. Someone's here going to roll a die. I get a 2, roll a die over here, and get a 4. Yippee. So, Earth's going to go first. I've already found my 2 rocks I'm going to use, obviously. That where I shuffle the deck, draw 3 cards. Turn begins. I'm sorry, go ahead and get 12 starting energy here on Bria. Turn begins. Now, since this is the first turn of the game, Bria does not energize. So we're going to go ahead and put down both Orochi and Goggles and Hubdo Spear. We're going to use Orochi and Goggles to kind of draw 2 cards, see what I got here. That's 4 and Karkic, or sorry, Karak. I'm going to discard. Actually, I'm going to not discard either of them. This could get a little tricky here soon. I'm going to skip my first PRS step, nothing I can really use. Obviously, you can't attack first turn anyway. Going to go straight to the play new creature spells, which I'm going to play Husp. And put 4 energy on that. And I'm going to go ahead and use. I'm going to spend 2 energy and use Submerge, which is, again, choose any one Orochi creature in play and add 3 energy to a chosen creature. In this case, it's going to be, obviously, Husp. Husp is a little weak there. And with only one creature in play, I need to be as powerful as possible. With that, I'm going to go to my draw step and end my turn. Now comes Called. This was a gamble, because for the first Called / Shadow Magi, it's actually an Ardariel Shadow Magi called Horror Night Stalker. Starting level with energy, energizes 7, so that'll help. She has no starting cards, but has the effect of Starfire. Magi can retrieve but not play their starting cards. Your cards cannot force other players to discard cards from their hands. And has the effect, again, of if any opposing Magi are core, decrease Horror Night Stalker's energized by 2. So, basically that means that if I can survive Bria, then whoever the next Magi is can retrieve the starting cards but not use them. Also, I can't force them to discard cards from their hands. So, our draws the 5 starting. anything decent? Actually, yes, we got an interesting relic here called Shadow Bones. Its power of Vitalize is 4/4 energy. Choose any one core creature in play, discard Shadow Bones from play, and add energy to the chosen creature equal to that creature's starting energy. This could get interesting. There's also a spell here. Oh, so I'm going to play Shadow Bones. Sorry. Everything's up here. I'm also got a spell here. Got Dark Portents. It says, choose one player. Reveal the top 5 cards of the chosen player's deck. Add 1 energy to your Magi for each creature revealed. You may discard one of the revealed cards. Put the remaining cards back on the chosen player's deck in the same order. So I'm going to... Oh, almost forgot. Starting energy plus energized cost, which is 7, for a grand whopping total of 18. Not bad, really. We'll start off by actually spending 2 of that to play Dark Portents, so I can look at the top 5 cards of the Orochi deck here. I will choose a creature, I believe, and add 1 energy to my Magi for each creature revealed. So spending 2 to gain a possibility of 5, I actually only gained 2 back, so I pretty much netted it. But I can also take a card and discard it. And then put the rest of the cards back on top of the deck in any order. Okay, let's see what we got. Undertow, Submerge, Parallet. I'm going to go and choose Undertow, this card, simply because I am not really ready. Not really ready for that. So either you're going to be Undertow or Submerged, but I'm not going to let him get Submerged next turn anyways. So, next we're going to go into the play new, I can't attack of course, play new creature spell. I've got three creatures here that I can have a little fun with. Now I've definitely got the energy to do it. And just take a look at my power again, make sure I'm reading this right. Yeah, we're going to have a little fun here. So first we're going to go ahead and spend 5 energy to play Dagok. With the effect of Dream Inversion, opposing spells, powers, and other effects that discard energy from Dagok instead add an equal amount of energy. Opposing spells, powers, and other effects that add energy to Dagok instead discard an equal amount. Maroon Magi can play Dagok, and Maroon Shadow Magi can play Dagok for 1 less energy. So in other words, effects that hit Dagok that could add energy instead take away, and those that take away instead add. And a starting energy of 5. Let's see. I'm going to hang on to you. Pay another 5 here. 4. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. For Corbrag. Korbrag has the power of Firestorm for 5 energy. Choose any one Magi in play. Discard Korbrag from play. Discard 2 energy from each of the chosen Magi's creatures in play. Discard 3 energy from the chosen Magi. Called Magi may play Korbrag. And he also starts with 5. And I was thinking about using the Shadow Bones, but I'm going to... do just that, actually. So for 4 energy, I can discard Shadow Bones, and we're going to add energy equal to starting energy to Korbrag for 5. So Korbrag is now up to 10 energy. And that ends my turn, so I will go ahead and draw 2 cards. So we're back over here with Aroth, and this is now getting interesting. Powers, relics, and spells. I'm sorry, energize first for 5. And, yeah, we're going to get real interesting now. We're going to go ahead and spend 8 energy from Bria to play Typhoon. Roll 1 die, and by 1 die, it's 1d6. Discard energy equal to the die roll from each non-Aroth creature in play. So, here goes nothing. Get a 3. So each non-Aroth creature loses 3 energy. Which, Dagok's not looking too well right now. So now we come to attack. Oh boy. So, here's the good and the bad of it. I could go and attack Dagok and completely get rid of him. Actually, I really just screwed up, hang on. Because Typhoon actually just added 3 energy. Because power spells are relics that add energy, lose it, and if they lose energy, he gains it, so he's actually up to 8. So that kind of slightly backfired. This is where things get interesting, though. I'm going to go and have Husp just take out Korbrag. I might as well take something down. So, in an attack, you compare... or basically, you go ahead and choose your attacker, you choose your defender, you go and choose what you're attacking. I believe... let me double check. I'm pretty sure... yes, it requires 1 defending creature. That's what I thought. So in this case, I'm going to go ahead and compare the energy costs, and they deal damage to each other simultaneously based on their energy costs. So in this case, they're each dealing 7 energy to each other. They're both wiped out. Now, this is where things get interesting. I need to play a creature now, because otherwise Bria's done next turn. So I will go ahead and place 4, which is 2 energy. That unfortunately drops Bria to 1. Kind of a bad time to place 4. Probably should have played it last turn, not thinking about it, but hey. And I will go ahead and use Parothian Goggles' ability to go ahead and check out the top 2 cards. And I am going to keep them both, and so my draw step, I just draw them in my hand. Next turn, we go back over to Aroth, and now things get interesting. Energize of 7. So we're up to a total of 11 here. 11 energy. Not really much I can do in power spells and relics. Yeah, I can't really play any power spells or relics. I'm going to go straight to attack. Now keep in mind that you can attack a creature multiple times, but you can only attack with a creature once. So Dagok's going to go ahead and attack 4. Now these deal 2 damage to each other. Dagok is going down to 6. Spore is eliminated, leaving Bria once again wide open. So I've got 11 energy to work with, and I'm going to spend downright 10 of it. So 4 of it to Gumph. But the power of Knight's Shade. Once per turn, when a creature is discarded from play, choose a creature, discard 2 energy from it. I'm not going to spend all of it. I'm going to save a couple of it. I'm going to go to Shrike. I don't know. Energy cost starting of 2. The effect Mindless Abandon. If you have no cards in your hand beginning your draw step, add 2 energy to Shireek. Dream Vengeance. If you have no cards in your hand at the beginning of your turn, add 5 energy to Shireek. So I'm going to go and play Shireek for 2. And I actually am going to go ahead and play my Rabbit Wasperine. The effect counterattack. It says immediately after one of your cards is attacked, you may play Rabbit Wasperine, paying all costs. If you're magizing your room shadow, add 1 energy to it when playing it. Rabbit Wasperine immediately attacks the opposing creature that just attacked. Actually, I want to hang on to that, could be useful. End of the turn, draw 2 cards. End it right there. I'm going to go one more turn just to kind of see if Bria can survive here. So Bria energizes. Total of 6 now. This isn't looking too good. Oh, I'm sorry. For 6, you're not going to get much down. Here's the deal. At this point, at this point, this isn't looking too good. Bria's best bet here is to do nothing. And here's why. They could... well, maybe not. This could be a little risky, but we're going to go ahead and try it here. So I re-energize. I have no power spells. I'll go and use Rothian Goggles again. Yay. Oh yeah, that could be handy. If I can survive a turn, that'll be handy. I'm going to play new creatures. I'm going to pay 3 to play Perilet. It's not going to be played for very long, though, because I'm going to play Life Channel, which is for 1 energy. Discard Perilet from play. Add 5 energy to your Magi. Discard 1 energy from each of your creatures in play. Actually, no, I'm not going to do that at all, because that's almost worthless. So, Bria's best bet is to do absolutely nothing. So, give me a second, I do want to check something here. Okay. We'll start the next turn. Horror go ahead and energizes.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
For 12 energy, he's literally about to just run over Bria. So we're going to place Warunder's Ring, which has the effect of phenomenal cosmic power. Oh, I'm not joking there. You see that. It says, at the beginning of each of your turns, choose either to draw an additional card at the end of the turn, or have all your core cards cost one less energy to play to a minimum of one to the end of the turn. I've got nothing else I can really do, so I'm going to go to the attack phase. Simply put, I'm going to have Dagok attack Bria. Now, when a Magi has no creatures in play, you can attack the Magi directly. Remember, a Magi is not eliminated until they have no energy left and no creatures in play. When a creature attacks a Magi directly, which, unless it says otherwise, you have to attack creatures if possible, the Magi does not attack back. So in this case, Dagok's dealing 6 energy straight to Bria. That eliminates Bria. In this case, Sarah goes ahead and puts Bria on the bottom of the deck. Any cards left in play are discarded, but that's all that happens right now. Go ahead and spend 5 energy from Horror to play Orok with the effect of Undermine. Whenever Orok loses energy in an attack, choose any one Magi in play. Discard half as much energy as Orok just lost from the chosen Magi round down. Okay. And there's 5. Pretty much, kind of on a roll here. Now, in the turn, draw 2 cards. Now, for Roth, their very next turn, they will go ahead and turn the next card face up. In this case, it's Wall. That's 10 starting energy. Even if the cards are in hand already, you can still search for the starting cards. In this case, I know I don't have Deep High Rent, so I need Karakin Submerge. Which there's Submerge. And you can only search your deck. I don't think you can search your discard pile. I'm trying to double check that because I don't have Karak in my deck. Let's see. So in this case, I can go ahead and get Karak out of my discard deck here, which I actually don't have a Karak. Where's my Karak? My only Karak's already in my hand, isn't it? Yep. My both Karak's already in my hand. In this case, the new Magi will now go ahead and energize, and the turn begins. You don't draw any extra cards at this point. Your turn now begins, and Wall is kind of screwed. In this case, I'm sitting here with 15, and I would spend just about all of it at this point. For those 3, and Submerge. So that's pretty much going to be all 15 energy. 5 starting, 3 starting, and then thanks to Submerge I can put an additional 3 somewhere. I'll go and put on another Karak to build it up. So again, that's it for the turn. So that's pretty much it for a few turns of the game. Yeah, that's really all there is to it. To keep in mind that once all 3 Magi are eliminated, you're done. I do have a couple reservations about this, about the game itself, that we'll go into here momentarily. For anyone wondering, I will go and go through one more core turn just to see how this turn would turn out. So an additional 7 energy. Go ahead and attack. I wanted to get some of these down quick. So I'll go ahead and have Dagok attack Karak. And Dagok will be eliminated. See, this is where the mistake comes into play. And this is where things... This is where I'll get to my reservations here in just a couple minutes. So Dagok is eliminated. I'm going to ignore that because it's not going to matter. I'm ending after this. Just kind of looking around here, I can easily mash these up to where the Shrike will take care of this Carrick. They're both eliminated. Gumpf takes care of Perilet. Gumpf stays at one. And then Orok will damage Carrick. They'll take each other out. Wall can't lose any more energy. And here's the... And you see the problem with this now. Wall has no creatures in play. He has no energy. Just like that, Wall's defeated. Now the good news is... Ooh, almost forgot. Play some creatures. I got some creatures I can play. Play Zalak. Has power supercharge. So you can roll a die here, add energy, discard energy, or discard Zalak from play, or add 3 energy to Zalak and 3 to the Magi. Nice little gamble there if you're willing to take it. I've got another Gumpf in play here, if I can put in play. If I really wanted to, I still got my Rabid Wasperine I could play. But, yeah, just like that, we're only about 4 turns in. And Oroth is pretty much done. So, in a few minutes, I will go ahead and give my wrap-up on the game, my opinion of it. And to see if it's really overall worth getting into. So, I will be back here momentarily. This is actually going to be a pretty interesting final analysis, actually. Alright, so... Just, what are my final thoughts on Magi-Nation as I continue to clean up here? The game can be fun. I mean, obviously it can be pretty fun. I mean, me and a friend invested quite a bit into the game. We've got quite a few decks. We've got a couple of the armies sleeved. We got a bunch of dice just for the game to act as counters. That we can also use them with games like Magic and such. There is one little thing I do have with the game. While it can be fun, it can also get easily one-sided. I saw during that practice game, I was going to stop after the Oroth deck revealed its second Magi. But I decided, you know what, let's continue on with one more turn for Kor, just see what would happen. And Kor just decimated Wall to the point that it ends the turn with 4 creatures in play. Well, actually 3. I could have put 4. But, I mean, I don't really know how good it would have done. I mean, next up would have been Orthea, who would have had a total of 20 energy. She could have probably built her defense if done right. But, I mean, there is a bit of strategy involved with Magi-Nation. But, if that's right, I mean, with some games like Magic, you can put a strategy into it to where if the strategy goes wrong, you can probably bail yourself out. I mean, I've had quite a few instances of that. In fact, just to briefly share one, get slightly off topic, I was actually playing a game of Magic against a friend of mine a while back, and I had a very hopeless situation in front of me. We were both using zombie decks, his obviously a lot better than mine, and he pretty much sent everything out to get me. He just fully unleashed. I had like maybe 3 creatures in play. I did the math, and I could have blocked 3 of the creatures. If I had taken it all, I would be sitting at 1 life remaining. This is where I had a couple strategies earlier on that didn't really backfire, but didn't really work either. So I'm sitting there thinking, and literally about a minute later, I just pick up my life counter, move it around, and now I'm down to 1 life, and ask him if he's done with his turn. And he just looks at me and says, "You're taking it all?" I said, "I'm taking it all." He said, "Okay, I'm done. Next turn, untap, draw a card, tap 2 mana, I cycled Jim Pomputer and wiped him out. Because there was more than enough zombies to take his life down to zero. If you're unfamiliar with Gen Palm Polluter or Magic, I believe it's a 5-6 creature or a 4-3 or something. I think it's a 5-6 black creature. They cost an insane amount of mana. But you can also cycle it, and if you cycle it, you can deal damage to an opponent. It's your deal damage, or they lose life, to an opponent for each zombie in play. Then between mine and his, there are enough zombies to take him out. So, give me a second, I need to go grab something. I almost forgot. So, the bottom line is, I've had strategies in Magic fail, and it looked like all was lost, and I made an amazing comeback somehow. That was an example. With Magi-Nation, as you just saw, four turns, and the game's almost over already. That is my issue with Magi-Nation. I found that out a lot when playing with my friend. I mean, we each had our games where he dominated me, or he beat me, or I beat him. Mostly he beat me, I think. But the main problem was, I think a lot of the time, it was just completely dominance. Because if your opponent gets a lot of creatures out there, you're almost screwed because it's really hard to come back on. Even with Magic, if you're facing a lot of creatures, it doesn't take much to come back. It doesn't take much strategy to come back. I mean, it does take strategy. But you can literally sit there against underwhelming odds and find a way to come back. Magi-Nation, it can be incredibly hard to do so. So like I just said and you just saw, the core deck just completely overran the Aroth deck. Now, I don't know if that's the deck or just really, like core versus Aroth may just be a really bad matchup. I don't know. But just a lot of times, it can seem incredibly one-sided. So overall, I like Magi-Nation. It's a fun game. I can kind of see where it would turn some people off, though, again, being so one-sided. Other than that, it is a fun game. If you can find a couple demo decks out there, or go to like a convention like Origins or Gen Con, and pick up a random starter deck to check it out, I'd go ahead and at least give it a chance. It may not be for everyone, but definitely worth giving a chance. So now that I finally got this one out of the way, the next review, I don't know when it's going to be up. I'm trying to get really back on track of making videos. The next video, though, I will take a look at a game I actually picked up from Gen Con last year. I'm finally getting to my Gen Con games. I'm actually going to take a look at Metabots. I never really got too into the cartoon, so I'm going in mostly blind on Metabots. I have looked at the manual a little bit, looked at the cards, don't remember much about them because, obviously, since I lost the original Magi-Nation video, I haven't really gotten the drive or anything to do this again. Now, after Metabots, I don't know where I'm going with that. Origins is upon us. I've still got my material from Gen Con last year. I'll probably get into a couple Gen Con games, or games I got from Gen Con last year, before I start on the Gen Con games I'm probably going to pick up this year. There are a couple, or at least one I'm looking for. I'm not going to give it away, but I guess in a way I already did kind of look at a Gen Con game last year, and that was Digimon. But, yeah, so next time I'm going to take a look at Metabots and see how that is, see if it's really even worth it. See if I can figure out why it died. So, that concludes Magi-Nation. Oh yes, there was one more thing I forgot to mention. The little white stripe of cards you saw. This, in Magi-Nation, is known as a 120 deck. 120 stands for 1 Magi, 20 cards. A typical Magi-Nation deck has to have at least 40 main cards, no more than 3 of any card of the same name, even if the names are alternates. For instance, if you have a Furrock, you can have more than 3, any 3 combinations of Furrock, Evil Furrock, Alternate Furrock, something like that. So Evil and Alternate versions of cards count as going towards a restriction of 3. But still, the basic deck in Magi-Nation, you have to have at least 40 cards, and you have to have 3 Magi. In a 120 deck, you have one Magi and 20 cards. So it's kind of like for quick plays. 120 games, they're quick, but obviously they're not going to be as one-sided sometimes as getting two Magi down in four turns. So this is my 120 Paradwin deck. Not too bad, could be better. But yeah, so that's what the white stripe in my deck box was for. So now Magi-Nation is done, and I will see you next time when I talk about Magi-Nation. Knock out, Metabots! I'm really wishing I hadn't lost the first video now. So, see you next time for Metabots. And I'm not deleting this video this time, I swear. Come on, it's a generation. We're fighting for the Magi-Nation. Count us in for some competition. Gonna battle with the opposition. One day there'll be salvation. Calling out from the Magi-Nation, yeah.